Hello, I'm Jonathan Wyner, and welcome to Are You Listening? This episode is all about excitation. It's about the use of exciters, and by extension, saturation and other nonlinear kinds of signal processing. What do I mean by nonlinear? Stay tuned and find out in a moment. But first, go to the iZotope.com website, click on the Learn tab, and learn things. You'll find videos, blogs, exercises, and practice tools, and pro audio essentials, and lots of things that you can use to help you do music production better. So please go to iZotope.com. Anyway, about exciters. This is an interesting topic from my point of view. Back in the day, all signal paths had color. Anytime you would run a signal through a device, and this is especially true when we were dealing with tube amplifiers on a regular basis, there wouldn't be a one-to-one relationship. You wouldn't necessarily get a flat frequency response. There would be some addition to the signal that would cause it to sound slightly different. Interesting thing about that is this would lead audio engineers and producers to choose gear based on its sound. A tube device might sound different from a solid-state device. Something that uses a triode in the amplifier stage as opposed to a tube is going to sound different. It was inescapable that you would get color or excitation or saturation. The use of transformers, a device that's at the input and output of audio equipment to manage impedance, to eliminate noise and ground loops and other kinds of problems that can creep into audio circuits, those also can be colorful. Well, now we've got digital, and so we've got this super linearity, right? You've got your signal, you pass it through a digital transfer stage of some sort, a cable, through a buffer in a computer or whatever, it sounds exactly the same. It is bit for bit accurate, no change. So if we want some of that color, if we want to treat a signal in a way that makes it sound a little bit different in the way that tubes might or transformers might, then we have to use something that we can call excitation or exciters. The notion of color and vibe, I think, that we associate with this idea is mostly created in the production stage before something gets to mastering. There's only so much that we can do in mastering to introduce, in the same way that you don't usually introduce a new instrument in mastering, in the same way that we do in recording or in mixing. Introducing a whole vibe and a whole treatment in a way that reinvents the sound is something that's difficult to do and still have it be convincing, still have it feel authentic. But sometimes a little bit of color, a little bit of vibe, a little bit of excitation can help increase the sense of presence or increase something about the aesthetic affect. You want something to sound like the 1950s, pulling in a tool that allows you to use a tube exciter, for instance, might help you do that. If you want something to sound like it was cut on tape, you can use an exciter to do that and everything that comes along with it. That's the basic notion. We're going after a sound, we're going after a feeling associated with maybe an era, or maybe just kind of a vibe. Exciters and EQ, on the surface of it, they can seem like the same thing. You might use an exciter to get a little bit more what we would call presence, a little bit more energy between 800 and 2500 hertz. So you get a little bit more of that edge, a little bit more of the clarity in the vocal. You can do that with an EQ as well. What's the difference? An exciter is an additive signal. It's distortion. It's actually using the input signal to then generate additional harmonics that were never in the recording in the first place. It's therefore important to be careful about how much you use, because it's really easy to go too far. It is distortion. And if you add distortion to your recording and go too far, it will sound like distortion. It might sound cool, but at some point, if you go too far, it will stop sounding cool and it will sound like too much. Before I give a couple of examples, I want to talk about one other aspect of this that makes it challenging to create convincing and good-sounding exciters in the digital domain, and that's something called aliasing. The short of it is, when we use an exciter and when we saturate a signal, it creates a lot of really complex, very high harmonics, And the result of it is a little bit of high frequency edginess. If you're using an exciter in the analog domain, we don't have that edginess show up. In the digital domain, we do. The way to fix this when we're building tools for computers to allow us to excite is to use a technique called oversampling. If we use very high sampling rates, we can avoid a lot of the oversampling, maybe not all of it, but we can approximate something that comes closer to the analog version of a tube circuit or a diode or what have you. When you look at ozone in the interface of the exciter module, you will see a word right here that says oversampling. When you enable that, it will reduce the amount of aliasing. And if you turn it on and off and listen carefully, you will definitely hear with the oversampling turned on, everything sounds a little bit smoother. It sounds a little less bright, a little less hashy. There are lots of different excitation modes here. If you want to exaggerate the amount of excitation so you can train your ear on the differences in the sonic effect of a tube circuit versus a triode, etc., you can do that. At the end of the day, I'll just start out by saying, I usually use settings about like this. In other words, no more than 5 in the amount slider, and mixing in 5 to 10% maximum. And this goes back to the idea of kind of an overlay of lots of color or distortion on top of something that's already been mixed and already been produced. I'm going to hit play on this track. This is a song where I think you can understand why I chose it for this application. This does feel a little bit like a throwback track to the 60s or 70s, where it might want a little bit more of that punchy mid-range glue. Excitation, I think, could be helpful. So I'm going to play that section again. Here's what I want you to listen for. When I turn the exciter on, and I'm using the triode, the dual triode excitation module right now, you get a little bit more clarity and punch through the body of the kick drum. You hear the note of the bass a little bit better. The vocal sounds a little bit warmer. But there are two other things that you're going to notice. You're going to lose very deep low end. And you're going to get a little less transparency in the top end, and it's a little bit more top end forward. That's the distortion. I'm going to exaggerate it so you can hear it in a way that's out of proportion that I would never recommend using. But let me play it again so you can tune your ears on the effect. So I think you can hear what's appealing about that treatment and also what's a little bit too much. It does sound a little bit distorted. So like I said, my ideal amount might be something more like this. Just a little touch. But now that you've tuned your ear to it and understand what we're listening for and what's going to happen, I think you'll notice the difference in the AB even with just a tiny little bit of the excitation. I'll start with it off. Now I'm going to try a different excitation mode. The overall effect will be similar because we're adding harmonic information, which is going to tend to focus our attention on the mid-range and the presence. But the harmonic series of what's being added will be a little bit different. So it'll be a subtle difference, but it'll be a real difference. Even I could do whatever I feel, and that's why I gotta run, but I swear I won't hide. Look for me, I'll be on the block. Polka dots on my dreads, and later I'll be So you can hear when I go to the tube mode, technically speaking, what we're getting is more even order harmonics. What it sounds like is it's a little bit smoother, a little sweeter, a little less mid-range forward. You can hear the note of the bass a little bit more clearly in the body of the vocal, but you don't get quite the same presence boost. And you don't hear the hi-hat and the top of the percussion in the track showing up quite as clearly as you do with the triode. So one more time, listening to that, I'll start with the dual triode. Another thing that you can think about and a strategy that you can use is if you want to really emphasize this idea of presence and focus on the mid-range, is you can apply excitation in a focused way in a single band in the spectrum. So I'm going to create a crossover in the tool where I'm splitting the signal at about 300 hertz, and maybe I'll even put another crossover around 6K, so I'm not adding a lot of excitation way up high. It won't show up as much in the hi-hat and the top of the rhythm track. And I'm going to turn that band off and my low band off, and now just add a little bit of dual triode, for instance, in the mid-range, and listen to what that sounds like. Now, the cool thing about that is we don't hear the bass instrument show up so much in the exciter. We don't hear the distortion quite as easily as we do if we're doing a full band excitation. So if I want a little bit of excitation, if I want a little bit more of that clarity and intelligibility and presence, this is a strategy that I'll use fairly often. You could even take this one step further if you had a track where you had rock guitars panned wide and you just wanted the guitars to come forward, is you could go into a mid-side mode and not add any excitation to the center and only do it to the sides and accentuate the presence out on the edges. Be careful when you're doing that, because when you bring out the presence on the sides, it will compete with what's going on in the center. So listen to that very carefully. There's another episode of Are You Listening about mid-side. There's another episode about what happens when you go into multi-band mode. I'm not going to spend a lot of time in this episode talking about that, but you don't get something for nothing. It's all about managing compromises. It's all about managing trade-offs. It's all about understanding the behavior of the tools. So if you want to know more about those, I would recommend you to those other episodes as well. The words saturation, exciter, excitation are all used somewhat interchangeably. If somebody's asking you to make something sound more vibey, they're probably referring to this basic idea. But there really isn't a difference from a technical perspective between the two, except in one respect. When people talk about tape and tape saturation, it's important to understand that when you use tape, tape does a lot of things along with changing the harmonic content of what you're recording. It will tend to excite the signal a little bit, give a little bit more intelligibility in the mid-range, but it also changes something called the phase state, or it adds something called phase rotation to a signal. And tape is generally non-linear in frequency response, meaning that it rolls off very deep low end. There's a head bump associated with tape that gives an accent, depending on the tape speed in the bass, and also trades off a little bit of frequency response versus distortion spec in the top end. So if you were to look at the modules available in Ozone, you'll see in the exciter module, there is a tape treatment available, which just adds the harmonic change that tape brings. There's also a tape module that does all this other stuff too. So if you're trying to compare apples to apples, don't compare a dual triode exciter to the tape module, because you're really not getting apples to apples. You're getting apples to like a Waldorf salad. It's like a lot of stuff along with your apples. But otherwise, distortion, excitation, you know, whatever word sounds better to you, go with that one. So I hope that's given you a little bit of insight and encouraged you to experiment with the use of exciters. There are some genres that really don't lend themselves well to excitation. Going back to the notion that exciters introduce distortion, it's rare that you can get away with exciting a fully acoustic recording. I don't think I've ever successfully used, nor have I attempted most of the time to use an exciter on a classical recording, but the use of the tools is applicable more to genres that are more aggressive, that need more edge, that benefit from that extra degree of presence. Otherwise, if you want a high fidelity version of adding presence, use an equalizer. So thanks for watching. I'll look forward to seeing you in another episode of Are You Listening? I'm Jonathan Wyner. Take care.